If you follow the news, you've probably heard the words Wuhan and coronavirus a lot lately. In December 2019, a cluster of patients was found in Wuhan, China, with pneumonia of unknown cause. The virus has since spread rapidly over the last month. There have been over 20,000 confirmed cases, according to the World Health Organization. While the majority of the cases remain in China, there have been confirmed cases in countries around the world, including several in the United States. The interim name of the new virus is 2019-nCoV. Coronaviruses derive their name from the crown-like spikes that adorn their surface, resembling the sun's corona. Coronaviruses are zoonotic, which means they are transmitted between animals and people. It remains unclear what the host animal of the new coronavirus is, though bats are a prime suspect. Experts think another animal may serve as an intermediate host, but they have not identified it yet. During the course of the outbreak, a number that you may never have heard of has shown up again and again. It's called the R-naught, and it's been a critical part of the scientific effort to understand just how transmissible the new virus is. Understanding what it is can tell us some useful things about all disease outbreaks. The R-naught is also known inside epidemiology as the basic reproduction number. It is a measure of how potentially infectious a disease is. What that boils down to, essentially, is the R-naught predicts how many additional people one infected person could get sick in a population with no immunity to the disease. In general, the higher the R-naught, the more infectious the disease. And the value of 1 is important when it comes to the R-naught. An R-naught less than 1 means the outbreak will peter out, whereas an R-naught greater than 1 means the infection will continue to spread. Here are some R-naughts from past outbreaks. Measles R-naught is an estimated 12 to 18. SARS, or sudden acute respiratory syndrome, has an R-naught of 2 to 4. It is also a coronavirus. Early genetic analysis suggests that the new coronavirus emerged from a virus related to SARS. So what is the R-naught of 2019-nCoV? An early scientific consensus is forming around an R-naught of 2 to 3. But the R-naught shouldn't be thought of as some silver bullet metric for the virality of this outbreak or any other. Infectious disease expert David FISMAN of the University of Toronto explains.
If you didn't know about an infectious disease and you let it just run through a totally immune population early on in the epidemic, how many secondary cases would you get for each primary case? That's what the R-naught is. It's right at baseline. And the reason people distinguish R-naught from the reproduction number later in an epidemic, sometimes called RE, which is R effective R, is that reproduction numbers change for a few different reasons. One of them is that people become immune, and that deprives the disease of new susceptible people to infect, and that slows epidemics down. The second thing that changes reproduction numbers pretty predictably and without vaccines or antibiotics or public health intervention is that people's behavior often changes in the context of epidemics. People react to them sometimes in ways that are helpful in terms of reproduction numbers and sometimes in ways that are unhelpful. If the outbreak was tailing off and everybody looks around and says, I can come out of hiding now because the outbreak's going away, you can have multiple waves of outbreaks. So that's one example of behavior change affecting a reproduction number. How do we calculate R-naught? Well, there are a couple of different components to R-naught. One is how many contacts does a case have per unit time? One is how likely are they, if they're infected, to infect each of those contacts? So it's probability of transmission conditional on contact. And then the third component of R-naught is duration of infectivity. So the longer you're infectious, the more people you can potentially infect, and that drives the reproduction number up. It's a unitless quantity, so you need to rescale the epidemic into bug time rather than people time, and we call that the serial interval, which is you can use R-naught to map out what an epidemic's likely to do, if you know what the serial interval is, and that's the average interval between a case becoming infectious and that case's average secondary case becoming infectious. That's how we talk about generations of infectious diseases. So you use R-naught in combination with serial intervals to figure out how diseases are going to grow. One of the frustrating things about a situation like this where everyone's sort of on edge and wants it to stop and go away is the time steps in this epidemic are 7 or 8 days. So people look at changing case numbers day to day. That has nothing to do with the underlying epidemic. That has to do with how many people are getting tested. So we really don't see the contour of the epidemic play out at 1 to 2 day time steps. It's week to week to week. So patience is the watchword. And I feel like you make predictions on this stuff at your peril.